Hello guys, so the question of today is, why would you use financial methods for evaluating a startup company? And the answer to that is because the public market does. So in the rest of the video, I want to elaborate on why this is the case. And to get started, I can tell you that on one hand, it's because of human nature, and I'm going to tell you why. And on the second hand, because as I'm going to show you, the public market has a direct impact on the way private valuations are defined. So let's get started. Let's first address the connection with the public market, public-private market, right? So the public market refers to the stock exchange, right? So in this case, we're talking about companies that are later stage, they are established, right? So all the traditional valuation methods apply, there's a lot of complexity. You can get lost in the art and science of making evaluation for these companies. But the thing is, these methods are based on financials, right? So you have the traditional DCF, you have the long-term growth, you have the multiple, you name it. And what is the connection with the private market? Well, the public market is the exit opportunity for a lot of private companies, especially for startups. If you are a VC firm or angel investor, you want to somehow be in the position of sell your stake. So for companies that are doing extremely well, the stock market is the natural exit. So just to give you an example of what happened last year in 2015, around October, November, the valuation of public tech companies kind of collapsed, starting with LinkedIn, then extended to Twitter, Square, and others, right? So the message that the public market investors were giving to private market investors is that the way companies are evaluated before going online, before the IPO, before going public with the IPO, is too high. So when companies are presented for the IPO, at the beginning there was like an initial welcome to the foreign market, but then public investors realized that the fundamentals of this company were not that good, and that's when they adjusted their expectations and the price of per share collapsed. But well, it went down, you know, I wouldn't say it collapsed, otherwise we'd be talking about failure, but that didn't happen, but it definitely went below the IPO price. So again, public market investors were saying, hey, we don't like the way you're evaluating companies in the private market, so you should revise the way you're doing that. That was the message. The message was well received by the entire private market, because if we look at the statistics for VC investments last year, or at least if you ever tried to raise capital from VC over the past 12 months, you would probably know that they raised the bar already at Series A's for the type of companies they want to invest in. So if before that you could raise Series A for 1 million with 10K MRR, now it's not the case anymore. They're asking you 30,000, 40,000 euro or dollars in MRR before even considering you for a Series A. So the implications of that is that the public market has a direct effect. That's the bottom line. So just to elaborate a little bit on what happened 1 year ago, you probably remember that a lot of companies that were pretty big startups like Uber or I don't know, some others that I can't even remember right now, raised a lot of capital on the private market at very, very high, like billionaire valuations. Airbnb is another, for instance. And why are these companies staying private? That's the question that a lot of people had. You know, why aren't they going for IPO to raise capital? And the reason is because probably they knew that the valuations they were getting on the private market were higher than those they would get on the public market, because apparently private market investors were more irrational than the public market. And that's kind of the truth, because we saw a lot of non-traditional investors into startups entering the market with a lot of capital and being willing to pay whatever price. This is the typical case of even hedge funds looking for returns going to the private market, or even corporate VC funds. There was an influx of a lot of corporate money into companies like Uber, Airbnb, maybe not specifically, but at that stage of investment into private companies. So naturally, if you have higher supply of capital, the valuation is gonna go higher. It's, you know, just supply demand law. But that increase in the valuation came probably at without having fundamentals backing that, and that's when the public market said, hey, we don't like that, we want to see more stable companies. As a matter of fact, there was a tech company, and the name is Atlassian, which is not something that not a kind of company that has a lot of PR, but they are public, and their price didn't drop. As a consequence, actually increased despite being a tech company. And the reason is their fundamentals of Atlassian's, which is known also for the chat, HipChat, which they bought a few years ago, they have extremely strong fundamentals. And the public market liked that a lot. So the problem was not with tech companies in general. The problem was with tech companies without strong fundamentals that were not meeting investors' expectations compared to one that went public, like Twitter, LinkedIn, or Square in this case, which were the most famous examples. So public market is very, very important also for influences on the private market up to the company on the stage where you are at, so the Series A. Why does that happen? Because VC firms in the end of the day raise capital from what is called LPs or limited partners that are can be mutual funds, and can be other kind of institutional investors, like very, very big institutional investors that are more inclined into using models to calculate the return as public market investors do. So the message that VC firms got is that, oh, if I don't tune down and I don't make like stronger returns, then I'm not gonna be able to raise another fund from the same LPs or from other LPs. So I'd rather be more selective in the way I first of all invest, and secondly determine the valuation. So that's what is happening in the VC world. I think we're gonna see definitely more analytics and definitely more data being made available and being disclosed about valuation and the way valuations are determined for companies that are raising. Their fundraising. Second reason why you would use financial methods also for startup companies or early stage companies is that it's in human nature. If you're investing in a company, how much you're willing to pay for the company as well as how much you're willing to invest in that company is determined by how much you believe the company can generate in the future. If you think that the company cannot reach the 10 million mark in terms of turnover, then you probably don't want to value that company higher than, I don't know, half a million, just to say a number, right? On the other hand, if you think that company can reach 100 million turnover, then probably you're willing to pay 5 to 10 million, I don't know. These are just numbers that I'm casting, so don't rely on them as realistic or reliable valuation estimates. But just to say, it's human nature to think about what's the potential, the economic potential of a company, because at the end of the day, you're not investing in non-profit. You're investing in companies that are gonna be able to make cash flows. So as much as it can be very, very speculative, the earlier the stage, and very difficult to estimate, you still want to have a rough idea of what the company's potential is. And it's good that you put that into context, meaning that if this company is a company you're considering is estimating to reach 100 million turnover, but the market size is not even 100 million in potential revenues, then you probably want to reconsider the financials of this company or even your investment in this company. So, again, it's human nature. Financials are nonetheless important. It's not the entire aspect of evaluating a startup. There are also soft and qualitative aspects like the team, the trends in the market, et cetera, et cetera. But it's definitely something that should still be considered. So neglecting them can be harmful for your fundraising. So that said, let's quickly go through the financial methods that we use in our technology on Equidem. So I would distinguish them in two categories, even though they are kind of similar. The first is the VC method, and the second is the DCF method. That has two different options. One is with long-term growth, one is with the multiple, but let's keep it simple. Let's just focus on DCF. So the VC method is a simplified DCF method, if you want, because the VC method assumes that from today till the moment of exit, you're going to ignore what happens in the middle, right? You don't want to calculate the cash flow for every year, blah, blah, blah. That's fair enough. You just want to say, okay, what is the potential in terms of turnover that this company can do at exit time, let's say in 5 years' time? More specifically, what you estimate is like the revenues minus the cost, so the EBITDA margin, so what is the operating margin of this company? And usually what you do is you use a multiple to calculate the terminal value. As we probably, as you probably saw or heard in the previous video, the multiple is a way to, it's a shortcut to estimate the value of a company if you would extend the performance of the company to infinity. So anyway, long story short, you just use the multiple that is taken from comparable firms You can even take public companies at this stage. Why? Because if you take an horizon of 5 years or even 10 years, you're assuming that the company is somehow going to be able to get to the point or even get public or to be as stable as a public company. So those EBITDA multiples are can be used. So you just estimate EBITDA times EBITDA multiple. What you get is the valuation, and then what you do with the valuation, which is 5 years down the line, is the terminal value, sorry, not the valuation, the valuation in the future, so terminal value. You have to discount it for the risk that you're gonna bear to get to 5 years in the future, right? The risk in the VC method is usually very high. We're talking about minimum 60%, but that can even increase based on the stage of the company. Very, very early stage companies probably are gonna have a higher return and high expected return. What we use are historical returns from VC firms as we observe them in the market. Something that I want you to understand is that in finance, like actually in life, to higher risk always corresponds higher return, higher expected return, I would say. I think there is no need to explain that, but it's the case anywhere. So low risk, then everybody can take it, and the return should be lower. The more you bet, the more you should gain, right? So the DCF, why the DCF, which stands for discounted cash flows? Why cash flows? Well, because accounting, what they say is accounting is an opinion, or profit is an opinion, and cash is the king. Accounting can be subject to regulation, standards, you name it. So it can become not indicative of the real profitability, the real performance of a company, because of the way it's reported. So it's common practice to only focus on the cash flows, which is in the end of the day what matters, right? You don't care if a company is doing 100 million in revenues if at the end of the day the cash flow is only 100,000 euro, for instance. The real profitability therefore should be based on how much cash is able to generate from the operations, and the cash flows you'll be using are those from operations, so not the cash flows from financing activities. It's like you have a negative cash flow from your operations because your business is not working, or whatever it is the reason, or you're just like in development phase, but you are able to raise capital every year in the form of debt or by issuing equity, so you have a positive cash flow at the end of the year. Would that add value? No, it doesn't. It doesn't, because that is just financing activity. It's not the core activity of the company unless you are a bank. So that's what we're focusing on, the operating cash flow. And we have a way to estimate that just starting from your revenues and costs. So you can check it out on the platform. So once we had the cash flows and we estimate them on year per year, and the reason why we do that is because we made the process and the procedure very, very quick and simple. Then we have to estimate the required return for every year up to the exit. The terminal value, right? The terminal value, as we said before, is calculated with the EBITDA multiple, the long-term growth. We can probably elaborate on that in another video. But just what is important to mention is that the required return is not calculated in a traditional way. We don't not calculate that in the traditional way as, say, on the public market, for instance, because in that case, you just estimate the return on equity. There's a lot of formulas about that, and you also have to account for the cost of the debt. Anyway, long story short, this is called the weighted average cost of capital. So we just use that as a starting point, because there is additional risk that comes into the game for companies that are private and companies that are early stage. And there are two other factors that we account for. The first is the survivability rate, or the probability that a company will survive a certain year. And we estimate that from historical data on entrepreneurial activity in your country and your industry, right? So we project that to the future and we say, okay, what is the probability that your company will survive year 2018, and we use that as a net discount on the cash flow, right? So that's the first thing. And the second is we have a system or a formula to calculate the illiquidity discount. What is the illiquidity discount? Well, it's an additional risk factor that we use for the lack of marketability of your company. Meaning that you're private. If I'm an investor in your company and I want to sell my stake, then I don't have the stock market where I can even sell one stock like as I wish. There's no liquidity, right? You have to find for a buyer, and that adds additional risk. So that's what this formula is all about. And we used a paper that was developed on companies that are with very low capitalization, and we use that basically for the companies that use our service. I hope I gave you a good overview of why financial methods are still relevant for startup companies. And I hope that this gives you like the right mindset to approach the topic of financials for your company, right? So it shouldn't be something like obscure, like hocus pocus. You should just be focusing on the core of what's important to project your performance for the future, you know, revenues and costs. Those are the important items for a company at this stage, especially when you don't have that much complexity from your track record, or you don't have any track record. So I think that this gives you like a good overview. If I went too quick or there are questions about that, please comment on this video. We're always very active in commenting and replying to comments to our readers. And other than that, then I'll see you in the next video.